Well, hello, friends. This here's David Vose. Today is April 17th, 2016. It's good to see everybody today. Well, it's another beautiful day in New Mexico, and the sun is shining. A little bit of wind, but not bad. So I thought today I would, because yesterday we were talking about how you're a slave. We've been talking about that quite a bit lately. And I think a lot of you kind of think that I'm talking sort of symbolic or parabolically we're a slave. You know, we're not really slaves. But that's not what I mean. Today I want to show you that you really are a slave. That you were really bought and owned and trained as a slave. And from the time you were born, you were given misinformation. They are purposely deceiving you. Because, see, the only reason they could do that is because they own you. You are their slave. You work for them. But this working arrangement that you have with these Baals, these owners, these husbandmen. In ancient times, there was the husbandman of the manor. He would own the manor, and everybody worked for him. This is the same thing we have today. Today, we're just calling it corporate leaders. They are the husbandmen, and we are all the servants. Today, we call it work or service, but it's the same word. We're servants. We do service. We serve the corporate leaders. Now, they own... See, this is where a lot of these people came from, because they came down through the Dark Ages in these elite families, and they had the earth all divided up like cattle. And it hasn't ended. The English, and it's not really the English that rules the world, just like it's not really America that rules the world. It's a group, elite group of leaders that live in America and over in Europe that run the world. A lot of them live in Austria and over by Hungary and Romania, southern Russia. That area now doesn't have as many of them. They've all moved over into the United States, but a lot of them still have their big castles, you know. They can go anywhere they want. I mean, you know, they are the ones who colonized this world. So they colonized Australia, South America, Argentina, Brazil, Mexico, the United States, Canada, the Virgin Islands, all of the islands and Hawaii and everything. We've conquered it all. We went to Africa, and if you look at each one of those countries in Africa, they've all got another little name by the name. It could be Congo, or it could be South Africa, or whatever. But right next to it is the country that colonized them. Could be Denmark or Germany or England or whatever. They all split it up between themselves. So the entire world, Australia, Africa, the whole world, all of these traditions and so forth, comes down from the elite that ruled over Europe. Now, we talked about in a lot of my videos that there's two different traditions and there's two different ruling classes and so forth. You've got those beings that are organized by spiritual forces that we're calling Marduk, because Sumerian tablets calls this god Marduk. In the Greek, he's Apollyon. In the book of Revelation, chapter 9, it says that this Apollyon is the leader of all the demons, of all the fallen angels, and that is Marduk in the Sumerian tablets. So in Greek, he has the name of Apollyon, or the destroyer, the son of destruction. This is the same person that Paul talks about in 2 Thessalonians when he says that the son of destruction. That word in Greek is Apollyon. So he's Apollyon. He's the angel of the abyss. And he's ruling the world right now. Because you see, Christ died and conquered all those principalities, powers, and dominions. But he did so in principle and in theory. But you as an individual are still required to overcome this world. But you see, Christ has showed us the way. He's conquered it for us. And this is really a symbolic drama because Christ is really in you. And you yourself are going to conquer because this Christ is in you. He's not going to fail. He's already conquered the world. And he's in you and he's asleep right now. But someday he'll be woken up. You'll be born again. All things will have become new. And you'll be a new creature made after that inner Christ, that spiritual inner man that Paul talks about, the inner spiritual man. But the outer man, it wastes away from day to day. And we got to crucify that. See, that's this physical world. Now, I really am going into this. I don't even know why I told you all of that. But basically, to give you the background of the fact that, well, what I was going to tell you is that there's the other group, and that's those who are trying to work towards the enlightenment of mankind in peace. Those people had orders, and they call them a sect in the New Testament. That was the sect of the Nazarenes. Jesus was the leader of that sect, and they were an esoteric school. See, a school is something. That's why Jesus was called a master, and his disciples, see, we call them disciples, but that word means student. And they were all his students, and they call him master. This was a real school. Elijah started the school of the prophets hundreds of years before this. And it went all the way down to John the Baptist, who was the master. And he had disciples. And when he died, his disciples were transferred over to Jesus. The point I'm trying to make is that since the beginning of time, there have been these schools. And there are two schools in the world. There are those who are in the school of the mysteries, who are learning the great mysteries and learning truths. Now, in those schools, there were things that were unlawful to speak. This is why Paul went into the desert for 3 years. And it says at the end of those 3 years, he heard words that were unlawful for him to speak. And what does that mean? Well, if you read Pliny or Josephus, they explain a little bit about these Essenes or these sects like the Nazarenes. The Nazarenes and the Essenes were really the same sect. They had different names depending on the location. Some of them were called Therapeutae. They were down in Egypt. Others were called Ebionites that were there in Jerusalem. The Essenes weren't in Jerusalem. Now, James the Just was the leader of the Ebionites. But John the Baptist was the leader of the Essenes until Christ came along. Christ was the head of the Nazarenes. It says that after Christ died, Paul was the leader, the ringleader of the sect of the Nazarenes. It says that in the book of Acts. And it says that they took upon themselves vows. Now, Josephus talks about these sects and says that they had a three-year course. The first 2 years, you gave everything you had to the poor. Remember how Jesus said, give everything you have to the poor and come follow me. Well, that word poor in Greek is Ebionite. See, he was in Jerusalem at that time, so he was telling this wannabe follower or disciple, he says, what shall I do to be, I want to be a disciple, a student. See, you're my master. And Jesus said, all right, sell everything you have, give everything you've got to the poor or the Ebionites. Join this order. Well, after 2 years of learning and going through this initiation process, you came to a point where you had to make a decision. If you made the decision to stay for one more year, you ended up giving everything you had permanent. The stuff that you gave them when you first got there could have been given back to you at the end of 2 years. By the end of 2 years, you gave it all. You were committed. And then they were allowed to give you the higher knowledge. And for that last year, you learned words that were, or information or knowledge that was not lawful to tell those outside the community. This is what Paul did when he went into the desert by Damascus, which was where the Nazarenes were. That's why he is called the ringleader of the Nazarenes, because he became their leader after he went through the initiation process. So these were schools, and these schools went down through Europe. These Essenes went into Europe and took up they made their headquarters there in Spain, all the way up until the year 1500. That's where we got the Kabbalah, the Zohar, and all the esoteric wisdom. This is where we got all the wisdom from people like Sir Isaac Newton and Galileo and all these great scientists and thinkers and philosophers, they were all students of the masters. And the masters go down through the masters of the school of the prophets back to Elijah. So this was the schools, this was the great priesthood. However, there was another priesthood. Now remember, Jehovah came down on this mountain, 1300 BC, and he started a lesser priesthood. And his priests were robes. But the problem with his priests is they would sacrifice animals. Because this God was angry, he was jealous, he was mean, and he demanded sacrifice. So they always had blood on their robes. So what that represented was the fact that their priesthood was a bloody priesthood. In fact, that's what Moses' wife accused him of, being a bloody man and having a bloody priesthood. So, then in the New Testament, it tells us that we should have these white garments that has no spot or stain or blood stain on it. The reason why the New Testament says that, see, they knew in those days what these things meant. What they were talking about is that we don't do any sacrifices. We're not a priesthood of death. So this is the other priesthood. This is the lower priesthood. Now, and in the Dark Ages, this lower priesthood continued on, and they began to carry on under the guise of teaching more of this veiling, this ignorance. Remember, Moses veiled the truth. So it's couched in deception and parables. It isn't the straight truth. And on the surface, it's a very dark, dark. There was a lot of death and destruction. So, during the Dark Ages, the Essenes began to enlighten mankind and teach this beautiful truth to the world. And it was great. And they made schools and libraries and colleges. And they would give you these degrees, and you'd go through this initiation process and learn this great knowledge. See, and this was wonderful. This was the school of the prophets. Well, the enemy saw this and he realized that he was going to fail. He was going to lose because knowledge was going to enlighten mankind and they were going to become wise and they would be able to do anything they wanted. Remember what the serpent told Adam and Eve in the garden. He said, in the day in which you eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you'll become like God, and you'll live forever. So you see, Christ came, and he taught man that they could be like God, that they could live forever. But Jehovah, see, he had told him, do not eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And if you do, in that very day you will die. And when they did, Jehovah got very angry at them. Now, this is very interesting. I go back to this because I want you to see something there. When Jehovah found out that they'd eat from the knowledge of the tree of good and evil, he cast them out of the garden. And then he went and killed an animal. And of course, when you kill an animal, there's a lot of blood. So this was a bloody garment that he put on Adam and Eve. He clothed them with these bloody garments. What he did was he covered them. This is, in Hebrew, this is the word that we get for atonement. It means to cover. And so the entire Jewish law, or the Old Testament, is about this atonement. Jehovah thought it was necessary that they be covered in this bloody sacrifice because they were guilty. Now remember, Jesus says that this God was an accuser. He accused us of being guilty. See, Jesus said, I don't accuse you. You have one that accuses you, and that is Moses. I don't accuse you. But the original accuser was Jehovah. He's the one who said, you will die. You were bad. You can't do this. You can't be like God. Jesus said, your father is from beneath. He's talking to the Jewish people. He says, he's a liar and a murderer. He drove Adam and Eve out of the garden. And he gave them bloody garments. So this was this veiled priesthood. The priesthood of the bloody garment. But remember, Adam and Eve, before they were in the garden, Elohim, El Elyon, the Creator and the Most High, created the whole heavens and the earth, and everything he made was good. And when he made Adam and Eve, male and female, made he them. And he gave them dominion over all the world, and they were naked, and they were not ashamed. They had no guilt. There was no guilt put upon them by our Father in heaven. It was Jehovah that put that guilt upon them. So you see, it's Jehovah, or the accuser, or the ego. I am, and there is none else. You will obey me. This is Jehovah. He's the one that writes these physical laws and puts this guilt upon your heart and condemns you. Jesus came to give us life, and that more abundantly. Jesus says, I do not condemn you. Moses condemns you, not me. But he says, I have come to give you life, and I have come to give you freedom. And if the Son of Man sets you free, you are free indeed. Because you see, the Son is free. He's the inheritor of the whole ball of wax. We own it. The only way Jehovah could convince us that we're guilty is to say that we're slaves. So this goes back to the point that you don't have to do anything that anyone tells you, because you are the king. You are the heir. See, Paul says we were allowed to be under this tutor, but it leads to Christ, because Christ is going to be born in us and we're going to become new creation. Born again. And that's who we really are. We need to identify with that spiritual man that's within us, not this outer flesh. Because the outer flesh is a slave and has been since the beginning. So, in the Dark Ages, now if you notice, all the pastors, Catholic priests, they all wear black robes. Now, why would they wear black robes? Because, you see, they're not ignorant of the connotation. Black means ignorance. It means deception. Now, why would... I mean, especially since in the New Testament, in the book of Revelation, it says we're all going to get white robes. So why then would priests, who are supposed to be pure and clean, and teaching this love and grace, why would they wear black robes? Because, you see, the only priest that wears a white robe in the Catholic Church is the Pope. And the present Pope formerly wore a black robe that was, he was part of the Jesuit priests. And they were the ones that did all the Inquisition and murdered all these people. But the reason they wear black robes is very important, because they know that, see, they don't know, but the ones above them know. The teachers know. The teachers know that they're not teaching them any of the truth. The bottom rung, the lowest level, is just deception. But now, remember, that's not the way it is in the Nazarene order. They didn't have black robes. If you look at, like, say, the Mormons, they wear a little white apron. Now, why do they wear an apron? This is the same thing the Masons do. They don't wear black robes. Now, why do you suppose they wear these little white aprons? Because, you see, this covering thing has gotten way out of hand. It was Jehovah that demanded to be covered from head to toe. See, it was Jehovah that made these bloody garments and gave Adam and Eve. But before all that, before the garden, before Jehovah ever stepped onto the scene, our Father in heaven created Adam and Eve and gave them dominion of the earth, and they were naked and they were not ashamed. You see, it was Jehovah that tried to tell them that they were guilty. And one of the things that made them feel guilty was when you covered yourself, it basically, the most important part you were covering was your private organs. So this is why you wore an apron. This was the part that was off limits. You had to be ashamed of being a human being. See, now in the Nag Hammadi Library, the teachings of our Lord Jesus, he says that when you can become like a little child and disrobe, then you have entered into the kingdom of our Father in heaven. Because you must become like little children. See, in our Bibles, it just says you must become like little children. What we don't know is that they've taken out the rest of that verse. You can find that verse in the Nag Hammadi Library. You must become like little children and disrobe, become naked. Because you see, Adam and Eve were naked and they were not ashamed. What Jesus was saying is you should not be ashamed. You're not guilty. Don't be deceived. He's a liar. He's an accuser, and he's a slanderer. He slandered Adam and Eve. He lied to them in the garden. The serpent told the truth. See, Moses lifted up the serpent, and the people were saved. And so, just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, everyone who looks at Christ upon that cross shall be saved. Because he represents the crucifixion of this flesh and the resurrection of the spiritual man, Christ. So this is a symbol of the Christ within us. That goes through all of this, that was born in this manger, this animal body, and it's resting quietly asleep in this little boat until he's woke up, and he takes command of the whole world, and the waves obey him, and the sea obeys him, and the wind obeys him, and he says, be calm. And everything comes to a rest because, you see, Christ has that power. You are a son of the living God. Your Father is from above. You don't have to worry about this God, this Father that is from beneath, who's the accuser, who slanders you. You're not guilty, friends. And so, you see, these bloody garments were never necessary. But only we're hiding our guilt, which was put there erroneously. Who put that guilt on your heart? It wasn't supposed to be there. It didn't belong there, friends. It was Jehovah. He's a liar. He's a deceiver. So, all the institutions in this present day has been usurped and taken over by the deceiver. And this is why he puts black robes on all of his priests, because, you see, they're only teaching deception. You're not going to see your bishop wearing white, because he's never going to tell you the truth, mostly because he doesn't know the truth. He has never been given the truth. He's never gone up to the higher order where you get that white robe. Now see, just because it says in the book of Revelation that our Father in heaven is going to give us white robes, doesn't mean that we need to have covering. See, Adam and Eve didn't have any covering, and they were not ashamed. We don't need covering. The only reason that we're going to get these white robes is because you feel guilty. And so our Father is having to say, well, you're not going to take away that guilt through your own works or death or a bloody robe. This worthless robe that Jehovah gave you, these bloody garments, it's worthless. We need garments that are unstained with blood. We don't need to make a sacrifice. We don't need to do anything. You see, when you kill an animal, you eat the flesh and you wear the garment. We don't eat flesh. We're not of the flesh. We're spiritual. See, in the Garden of Eden, they didn't kill anything, but they ate the fruit. And there's two kinds of garments. There are two kinds of white garments. There's linen, which you get from flax. It's something you get from nature, and it's pure white. Or you can wear cotton. Cotton comes from nature, from a plant. See, you can wear a cotton or a linen garment. It comes from nature, from your very internal nature, the way you were created by your Father. You don't need to get there through works, through this carnal flesh. So you see, our Father in heaven is saying, look, you don't need garments, because I'm going to provide this righteousness by nature. You have it within you by nature. I'm going to give it to you as a free gift. Not like Jehovah's demanding that you earn it and you be condemned. He's a liar. So when you go to a judge here in this country and you stand before that judge and he's wearing that black robe, you must understand that he's not going to hand down any righteous or wise decision, because he's not privy to that knowledge. He doesn't know. He believes in guilt. He's going to slam that hammer down and accuse you. Unrightly so. He is the servant of deception, and his robe is glaring proof. He is a servant of deception, of Satan, and his black robe is glaring proof. And so are the bishops and the priests of the Presbyterians and the Methodists and the Lutherans. A lot of these Protestant churches They don't even wear robes anymore. But you see, these traditions go all the way back. Now, a lot of you go to school. Go to school to get a degree. What happens when you graduate? They parade you up there on the stage, and you all get a black robe. Well, have you ever noticed that some of you have like little tassels and they're different colors? Because the tassels tells you what degree you have. Because you see, you have orders and colors. But all of these colors, you're never going to get a white one. Only the Pope gets the white one, because you see, he knows what he's doing. And you notice the cardinals, they wear red robes. Now, why is that? See, that's that bloody robe. They have gotten to the point where they've made a conscious decision. They've made a sacrifice. So they're given the knowledge. They're privy to the fact that all of these students that they have, all of their bishops and priests throughout the world, are only going to be wearing black robes. They're going to be filled with lies and deceptions and evil. And they're going to be handing down this deception and weaving their web of lies to the rest of the world. And you're living in that web of lie. And you're living today in this society in a web of lies, which was taken over by Satan from the very beginning. And when they came over here to America, see, in the great tradition of the ancient priesthoods, they started wearing their robes and they had these initiation processes and the degrees and all of these orders and so forth. So you think, oh, we don't have priests anymore. Oh, yes, we do. They're not going to give up their little... You see, sometimes you wonder, how's this world run? You know, it's just so smooth. It's like, we're told that it's just accident. It's just, we just invented this stuff in America in the last 200 years. This is not, we didn't just invent this. We're still being ruled over by our masters. And they've got us all wearing these little black robes when we graduate, just to let us know that we really didn't learn anything. They're just teaching us lies and we're not worthy of the truth. When we go and, you know, step up there before the judge and he's going to hand down the decision, and we don't even notice he's wearing a black robe, because he doesn't have any knowledge or truth, and he's not going to give us any justice, and he's not going to give us any wisdom. But if you notice, doctors have white robes. See, docere in Latin means teacher, because you see, when you reach the level of teacher, you get to have a white robe. This is why the Pope wears a white robe. Well, a lot of people say, no, doctors just wear white because they have to be clean, because they're doctors, right? And it's that's why when you go to school, it only takes you 1 year and you get a degree, right? You can get a degree in business or this or that or whatever, a bachelor's degree or whatever. You're still wearing black. But when you go through school for 6 to 8 years, you reach this level of teacher and then you get your white robe. There's levels above that. PhD, scientist, chemist, physicist, they all wear white. But you see, you and I are never given these white robes. And those today, in our modern age, who get these white robes, what are they learning? They're not learning religion. They're learning science. They're learning truth. Now, granted, the Jesuit priests, the black robe priests, have taken over just about everything. And they've infiltrated every organization and twisted it around. And though doctors are supposed to be teachers, they've become dupes and they're teaching lies as well. So they've infiltrated the whole world now, and there isn't any more truth in this world. You see, now I wanted to say before that our Father in Heaven doesn't give black robes out. He doesn't teach deception and then until you're ready, and then he gives you a white robe. You see, yes, there were things that were unlawful to speak, but what that means is, like Christ, he says, he spoke in parables because the crowd were not ready to hear certain things. You had to go through a certain initiation to see if you were ready. But that doesn't mean that in the Nazarene school, they gave you a bunch of deception and lies for the first couple of years, put black robes on you. No. They told you straight up, we're going to tell you many beautiful and wonderful things, things that you've never even imagined before. We're going to give you knowledge, but we want to see if you're willing to give everything you've got, give us all the stuff you own. Remember Ananias and Sapphira, they told Peter and the apostles that they were going to give them everything they had. They wanted to join the they wanted to join the brotherhood, the communal order there that they had. It says they had all things common, and they were bringing all their things and giving them to the Ebionites or the poor. Well, they brought their stuff, and they said, this is all we've gotten. We're giving it all to the Ebionites. And the apostle said, because they had spiritual wisdom, and they knew that these people were lying. And Peter called him out on it and said, you're lying. Your heart isn't right. So you see, they had to prove that they were willing to give everything for this knowledge. And even today, you must be willing to give up everything for the truth. If you're holding on to the world, see, anyone who's a friend of the world is not a friend of our Father in heaven, because the world is a wicked and evil place. And if you're going to live in the world, you're going to be a doctor, a modern doctor. You're going to have to prescribe evil drugs and lie to people. If you're going to be a judge in this world, you're going to have to hand down evil decisions and torture people and put them in prison. And you cannot be a friend of our Father, who is a friend of love. You cannot be a child of the living God if you're going to do these kind of shenanigans. These two priesthoods are separate. They're nothing alike. Our Father in heaven does not offer dark robes. But you see, these Jesuits, these black-robed priests came in, and they started infiltrating the schools of the prophets. And today, they've taken over everything. They've taken over the banks. They've taken over the organizations that where we go, institutions of religious instruction. And they start putting these black robes on all the priests because they said, we don't want the priests to have truth to teach the people. We're going to teach them a bunch of lies. And so now, here's the big revelation, friends. If you have gotten it already on your own, please pay attention to what I'm going to say. Do you go to a church? Are you Presbyterian, Catholic, Methodist, Lutheran? In your church, does your bishop teach you the truth, or is he teaching you lies? Your church was infiltrated by Jesuit priests a long time ago, and they're teaching you nothing but lies, friends. They're teaching you lies. They're deceiving you. They're handing down judgments of evil upon your children. And they're enslaving you. And yes, friends, you are a slave. So, I really hate to be the bearer of bad news, but this world that we live in has been corrupted. It's been infiltrated. And even though Christ died upon that cross and gave us all the freedom, and he loves us, and we passed over from death to life, and there's no condemnation in us, we have conquered. Yet, Paul says, many loved not the truth that they might be saved, but they loved darkness rather than light. And so you willingly accepted these lies. And you invited these evil people into our institutions and into our churches and into our government. And now you've got these black-robed deceivers running our church, our government, our schools, our education, everything, right down to the brass tacks. Everything in our society has been taken over by this darkness. And it's up to you and I, friends, to get the word out so that the light can shine and people can wake up. There isn't any other way, friends. If you think we're all going to come out of this spontaneously, just whoo, we're all just going to wake up. It's not going to happen unless you do something. It's up to you. You need to go out there and start proclaiming the good news. And the good news of the gospel is the good news of grace and eternal life. It's not deception. We're not going to wear black robes, and we're not going to attend a church that wears a black robe and has been for hundreds of years teaching us lies. Please, friends, wake up. You need to get out of these churches that are teaching you lies. Get out there and protest these wicked judges that are sitting in our courthouses handing down these wicked and evil decisions that are torturing the people and imprisoning us. We need to boycott these people. And we need to start telling everybody the truth and proclaiming the Lord's day of salvation, because it is here. It's been here for 2,000 years. We've been saved. This is the day of salvation, friends. Are you willing to receive eternal life? Because with the mouth, one confesses what is already received in the heart. So just receive it in your heart. Just know in your heart and your mind that you're saved, you're free, you're not under any condemnation. Nobody can accuse you because your Father has set you free. Now go out there and get this truth out to the world. Here's David Vos. We'll see you guys tomorrow.